Ezekiel chapter number 22. The book of Ezekiel chapter number 22. When you find the place that you will stand with me and reverence the word of God, I'm going to begin reading from verse number 28. Then we're going to take a brief look at this entire chapter and give you the thought this morning that God is telling us something. The Bible said in verse 28 of Ezekiel chapter 22 that you find that when it's lamentation, that Jeremiah is a handgun. It's a Jeremiah lamentation. That's Jeremiah lamentation. Which way is it? Which way is it? It's Jeremiah lamentation. It's Ezekiel. It's praying. And I'm just going to put some things together. And you know, I'm not sure about anything except I'm saved on my way to heaven. Verse 28, and her prophets have robbed them with untempered mortar, speaking vanity, and divining and giving lies unto them, saying, thus saith the Lord God, when the Lord hath not spoken. And if you're paying attention in the world today, you know there's a lot of people that are supposed to be representing God. They're saying things that God didn't say. This morning, they'll tell you if you love God, serve God, sow a $20 seed or a $100 seed, you'll never believe that story. I want to give you something. It was Jesus that told him to get in the boat and go to the other side. They were in a storm doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. I can't get over that this morning. The Bible tells us about prophets that would come along and revive people. Amen. I appreciate the Lord for this truth. The Bible says the people of the land have used oppression, exercised robbery, have vexed the poor and needy. Yea, they have oppressed the stranger wrongfully. The text is going to come from verse 30. And I sought for a man among them that should make up the heads and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found none. All kinds of religious people, but he couldn't find one to stand in the gap for the land. Therefore have I poured out my indignation upon them, and I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. Their own way have I recompensed upon their heads, saith the Lord God. You can be seated. Please pray for us this morning. Pray with us. Father, thank you this morning for the scripture. Lord, the word of God is precious. And I pray, Lord, you would use it. The text, the word of God today, to speak to our hearts. Help us, Lord, that we might be an effective witness for this, in this generation that we live in. God, I pray that you would bless our people that are gathered here today. This day, God, I pray that you, especially our Father, visit those our Father that don't yet know you in the free pardon of sin. I pray their heart would become so heavy, that the load would get so heavy that, Lord, they would understand and know there's only one place to unload, and that's in Calvary. God, I thank you for giving your life that we might have life and have it everlasting, have it eternal, and, Lord, have it abundantly. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We've been preaching for several weeks now on this subject, standing in the evil day. The text came out of the book of Ephesians, chapter number 6. And right now, as far as I know, there's one more message that I'm going to be preaching that on Wednesday night, and I'm reading on that subject. I said, as far as I know, I think if we end up here, the end of the month, Friday, God, I just want God to lead me to heaven and to guide me. In the text today, God is looking for a man And the place we would be to stand today, and the people that are standing, is the gap. You see, there is a gap between God and man. There is a gap between beloved and nation that's walking in an ungodly manner and the God of heaven. And God says, in the midst of it all, I'm looking for a man to stand. Years ago, I explained, it's like we're left here as God's people, and we have the privilege to take someone that's lost in one hand, and take the Savior in the other hand, and introduce them to each other. And when it's done right, we're in the background. Savior gets all the glory. Amen. But here, it's probably been more emphasized on a national basis. Israel is in trouble. I'll make a statement this morning. You don't have to agree with me. But America is in trouble. The parallels that I have looked at in this text are unbelievable. It's almost like we could be reading about our own country. And God said, I'm looking for a man in the evil days that is standing in the day. Let me go back. There's three things I want to share with you this morning. The first thing is the sin problem. The sin problem. I want you to see it in the text, okay? We don't spend a lot of time there, but I want you to see it in the text. It's not something I made up. It's the Word of God. And by the way, a lot of people are hung up. They believe our problem is political. They believe our problem is economical. But honey, I'm going to tell you, America's problem is a sin problem. We have a sin problem. We put our stamp of approval on so many things that God highly disapproves of. Now, I don't have to go into all of it this morning, but if you don't look at me right in a moment, I will. Amen. I'm telling you, beloved, it's okay to take the prayer out of the school, but you pray in any prison you want to. It's okay to take the Bible out of the school, but you can take Bibles by the stack in any prison that you want to. We're messed up. Say amen. It's okay to go across the sea and fight for another nation's border and not defend our own. Spend billions and billions of dollars. It's okay. With some, come up until the time of birth. I believe that the man's name, maybe you're not supposed to name names, but I'm trying to remember, and I will. Ralph Northam. You know when he lost the election? When he got on the radio in Virginia, and he said this, we'll lay the baby out on the counter, and then we'll have a discussion with Mama. I mean, I'm just saying, God, they did that. God saw that baby when it was conceived, amen, let alone laying it out on the counter. I'm just giving you some examples. We come along, you know, and we legalized religion, and now we're legalizing the drugs. Let's get some tax money off of it. I mean, I'm going to tell you something. When you legalize what's wrong, I said, when you legalize what's wrong, you're going to spend way more trying to keep up with it than you'll ever make. Amen. It'll cause more problems. A sin problem. Now, before I go any further, let's just read a few verses of Scripture. The Bible said in verse 2, well, let me read verse 1, because it says, Ezekiel said, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, by the way, let me stop and say this. God does not leave himself without a witness.
There may have been not one that was willing to spare them the gap. God was looking for one. But he had a man by the name of Ezekiel. He could speak to that man, and that man was not afraid to give him the word of God. Amen. The Bible said, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, now thou son of man, wilt thou judge the bloody city? Yea, thou shalt show all her abomination. That's what the word of God said. He said, Pastor, do you mean the children of God have gotten in such a state that God said it was abominable what they were doing in his sight? That's exactly what the Bible says. If you look down at verse number 4, he said, I made thee a reproach unto the heathen and a mocking to all countries. If you haven't figured this out yet, beloved, there are countries around the world mocking the United States of America right now. Beloved, we're weak. Amen. And we're weak because we're full of sin. And there's nobody crying aloud and spare not, lifting up their voice like a trumpet and telling the people about their sin. Amen. And by the way, beloved, let me just say this. It's hard to get somebody to cry out in the church, let alone in the nation. The average preacher today will not cry aloud. He's afraid for his salary. He's afraid for his position. And I'm telling you, God's men were preaching before a salary was involved. And God's men will be preaching that there's no salary involved. Because man does not call God's men. God calls his men. I'm not boasting in that. And I'm telling you, when the rubber meets the road in this country, and they come with the handcuffs and shackles, if you don't stop calling out their abominations, you'll find out who God's men are. God's men's not going to stop preaching because somebody said stop. Daniel didn't stop praying because somebody said stop. The old boys didn't stop. Amen. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego living for God just because somebody said there's the idol and you're going to bow to it. Honey, they didn't stop because they belong to God. Notice Peter, he said, I made thee a reproach unto the heathen and a mocking. I don't know about you. I love our country. My grandson called me yesterday. If he listens to this, I don't think he would mind me saying this. But 2 years ago, I would have thought he would have been in jail by now. Living a rough life, going the wrong way. He spent several months at different times in juvenile facilities. But there was a tempting to Bristol. He walked that sawdust trail. I haven't seen a lot of fruit, but I do thank God he's not in jail. And he called me the other day, and he said, me and my girlfriend's been talking. He said, you know, we need to start going to church. He said, well, that ain't the one we're going to. That's Chapel Church. They're supposed to be here this morning, and both of them hacking and coughing. And this is what he said. He said, Papa, can we wear a mask and come? I said, Jordan, no, don't do that, son. I said, stay home. I said, I'm not telling you anything. I'm not telling our own people. If you stay, stay home right now. He said, well, Papa, if we get better, we'll see the way tonight. He said, Pastor, what are you trying to say? I'm trying to say, listen, there's some young people in the world that still want to hear the truth. They don't want their ears tickled. I love our country. There's some people that love our country. And God's looking for a man to stand in the gap for the Lord. It's a sin problem. The verse number 8, thou hast despised my holy faith. The Bible said in verse number 9, men carry men that carry tails to shed blood. I tell you what, you listen to me real carefully. You get mad, you won't do. I tell people all kinds of people like that. There are a lot of people going to be mad at the priest. But you let one police officer, whether it's right or wrong in the confrontation, mess up and kill a black man, honey, they'll burn the city down. But you let black men in places like Chicago, where 30, 40 of them every weekend, shoot nobody knows your name. And you say, Pastor, what are you trying to say? I'm trying to say Chicago is like New York. It's like, beloved, San Francisco. It's like spread of cancer all through our country. There's a sin problem in our life. The Bible said here, the tarry tales shed blood. They commit lewdness in verse number 9. In verse number 11, one has committed abomination with his neighbor's wife. Another has brutally defiled his daughter-in-law. Would you look at this? And another in thee has humbled his sister, his father's daughter. He said, Pastor, how in the world could Israel get so far away from God? Do you ever stop and ask yourself this question? How in the world could a man get so far away from God? The Bible is talking here about a sin problem. The Bible said in verse 14, can thine heart endure? Can thine hands be strong? In the days that I shall deal with thee, I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will do it. Listen, I'm not a prophet, I'm a preacher. But I've been saying for years now, our day's coming. We're going to get so hard, hit so hard, we ain't going to know what it is. If we don't turn, as a country, I'm telling you, I'll get to some of the solution in a moment. Right now, we're looking at the problem. It's a sin problem. He said here, I will scatter thee among the heathen. He said, and disperse thee in the country, and will consume thy filthiness out of thee. Honey, everywhere you turn, there's filthiness in the land. I'm not just talking about that that's physical. That's emotional, that's spiritual wickedness in high places, filthiness in the land. The Word of God said this, in verse number 16. He said, Pastor, what's God so concerned about? The Bible said, thou shalt take thine inheritance in thyself in the sight of the heathen, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord. He said, Pastor, why would God ever judge a nation? Because he wants that nation to understand and know that, listen, you got too big for your business. You're not the Lord. You're not your own God. That's what secular humanism teaches. You're your own God. Do right what's right in your own eyes. Honey, we better understand there's a God we're going to answer to one day after a while. They saw, and the Bible says, thou shalt know that I am the Lord. Son of man, look at verse 18 just a moment. The house of Israel is to be become dross. Listen, if you know anything about refining silver, you put it in a pot and you turn the heat up under it. And beloved, the dross is that that flows to the top. The silversmith knows that he's got the heat just right when he can see his reflection in the silver. But you can't see the reflection until you take off the dross. He said, Pastor, what is the dross? It's the waste. It's that that's no good. It's that that ruins the silver when it's mixed with it. So there has to be some heat to get it separated. And God is telling the nation of Israel, you're not like the silver anymore. I can't see my reflection in the silver anymore. You're like the dross that skimmed off of the top. That's what God is telling me. I don't enjoy preaching like this, but somebody has to. Somebody has to tell the truth. God's still looking for a man in this evil day that will stand in the gap for the land. It's got a sin problem. The Bible said here, so in verse 20, will I gather you in my anger and in my fury. Or you go to some churches, honey, you'll never hear anything about God being angry. You'll never hear anything about the wrath of God. You'll never hear anything about the fury of God. I went to a visit a while back here, just a month or so back. I knocked on the door, and the Lord told me I remember his face. I remember his name. He told me, he said, I went to church, and it was here in Kingsport. He said, they preach love, love, love. He said, all they preach is love, love, love. He said, my mama died and I didn't hear from nobody. And he said, I wondered, where's all the love, love, love? I'm going to tell you, somebody that loves you, they'll preach love to you. They'll preach grace to you. They'll preach mercy to you. And I'm telling you, they'll tell you about God that's angry with the wicked every day. They'll tell you about a heaven to gain. They'll tell you about a hell that's gone. They'll tell you about a God that's not only a God of love and mercy, but it's the God of wrath and judgment. It all depends on which side of the cross you are. One piece of favorite said, Lord, remember me. You know what he experienced? The mercy of God. Jesus looked at him and said, today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. You know what the other one got? Exactly what he deserved. That piece looked over at him and he said, you and I get our just reward. We get what we deserve. This man, Jesus, has done nothing amiss. And yet he's dying in the midst of two things. Beloved friend, there's a sin problem. I hope we've established that. He said in verse 24, thou art a lamb that's not cleansed. In verse number 25, he said, they have devoured souls. They have taken the treasure and the precious thing. Let me stop and say this morning. While we're on this note, I can't remember the state. I believe it was out in the Midwest. You can look it up. But they got a drag queen to take over the elementary school. And the drag queen hired another drag queen. You say, Pastor, where in the world did you see that? Let me tell you something, the most precious asset that America has is our children. And dear God, we're going to sit still and not stand in the gap. Rather, it's our children and our grandchildren. Stand on it! Government says they have October 5th dead body. They're not the government. Mama, daddy, God give you them youngest. Raise them. If you got a brain in your head and a heart in your chest, train them in the nursery and the admonition of the Lord. That's their only hope in this evil world that we live in. Their only hope. The Bible says here, precious things. I can't think of anything more precious than these little ones. I can't think of anything more precious than these little ones. The Word of God says, her priests have violated my law. Here comes that religious crowd now. By the way, they know better. If anything, they're worse. I will go ahead and say it. I believe hell will be harder for a man that teaches people. If you'll put that wafer on your tongue, let me put a little water on your forehead, you'll go to heaven. I believe hell will be harder for people that are deceiving people. Amen. I believe hell will be harder for the leaders, beloved, that would say something out here, sign this little card, adorn our organization. I'm telling you, beloved, we need somebody that will say what Jesus said to Nicodemus. You want to go to heaven? You know you must be born again. You must come by way of the cross. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I believe Jesus, don't you? He said in verse 26, they profane my holy name. Look at this. They put no difference between the holy and the profane. Neither have they no difference between the unclean and the clean. Let me say something to you this morning, beloved. Listen. The church is the people that's been washed in the blood of Jesus. That doesn't make us better than others. That makes us God's children. It ought to make us be concerned for others. How many remembers when you weren't God's child? You say, Pastor, we're all God's children. No. You listen to what I'm not saying to you. We're all God's creation because of our first birth. You can only be God's child when you have a second birth. You must be born again. You see, Jesus looked at that religious crowd and he said, ye are of your father, the devil. That's what he said. And the lust of your father will you do. But tell you what, when a man gets saved, he prays daddy. He gets in a different family. He's headed in a different direction. He's got a new song in his heart. But the man said he's coming back with the hammer. When he gets saved, put no difference. Put God quit the Christian. Because their eyes to my side is not the same as I'm doing. Look at verse number 27. Her face is in the midst thereof, or like wolves. Have heard of wolves who keep clothing? Listen to this. They're like wolves ravening for prey. He sheds blood. Look at this. To destroy souls. To get dishonest coming. Is anybody reminded of America while I'm reading this morning? I mean, it's going on every side. Amen. The answer is not an all or a deed. The answer is just Jesus. The answer is not Republican. It's not independent. The answer is coming once again to the God of heaven. Say something like this. We are sinning against thee and against heaven. And God with untempered mortar. In other words, beloved, there are churches you can go to. They don't even carry the mortar. You say, what's the mortar? What's holding this thing together? By the way, amen. What does it mean if it's untempered? It means you put it between the bricks and it won't hold it together. Amen. Tempered mortar will hold it together. You say, Pastor, I'm worried about the church. I'm going to tell you something. I'm not concerned about the church. Let me tell you what I'm going to say. It's his church. He'll take care of it. Amen. God will take care of his own. Amen. But I am concerned about our country. And I'm concerned, beloved, about the direction that we're headed in. We see the sin problem. Have we covered that okay? Let's look at the second thing in the message. I want you to see the Savior's proposition. There's a sin problem. Now, I want you to think about this proposition for just a moment. The Bible says here, I sought for a man among them that should make up the heads. Now, wait a minute. I'm an American. Will somebody say amen? I don't think we can American. But God's not looking for a man among the Chinese, or among the Indians, or among the Philippines, the Filipinos. God is looking for a man among them. He's looking for a man. You know what I said? Among them. You want to see a picture of the grace of God? After everything that I've read this morning, Brother Dale, last night, I wouldn't be looking for a man. I'd just go ahead and do what needed to be done. They spit in my face. I'm telling you, listen, it's a religious crowd. And beloved, there's a man that's got his daughter-in-law. He's got his own daughter. There's another man that's got his neighbor in religious. There's blood that the baby's the most precious thing in the world getting killed. Amen. I just go ahead and bring fire down on him. But God says, well, let's just come out here. I'm looking for a man. I'm looking for a man. Listen to me. He said, Pastor, I'm just one man. That's all God's looking for. One man. That's what he's looking for. One man. That's the Savior's proposition. I sought for a man that would stand in the gap. You know what Moses was? He was a man. You know what he did? He stood in the gap. He said, God, he said, don't block them out of your deep. God, you're going to be ready to block me out of your deep. That's a man right there. You say, Pastor, what about New Testament? How about the Apostle Paul? He said, I would have to be a curse from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. God, give me a thought, Brother Jason. Brother Jason knows the heart of several of the people in the church. Not many. I'm scared of the whole church, but God has helped us in our hearts and in our minds. We see a way to organize the visitation. And I just thank God for what he's doing in our hearts and in our lives. But I'll tell you what God said to me this morning. There it is. I've written. He said, don't you ever let organizing take the place of agonizing. We need somebody that'll agonize on behalf of the country that we live in, on behalf of Bloomingdale, on behalf of our families, on behalf of our children. We need somebody that'll get in the throne room of God. I'm telling you, beloved, God is still merciful. You say, Pastor, what is the Savior's proposition? Here, Brother David, he said, I saw for a man. He put you for one. And y'all know, if you got sisters up today, if it weren't for the ladies, all of us men have been praying. So when it says a man, it could be a lady to stand in the gap. By the way, I don't think there's anything more beautiful in the world than a lady that's a prayer warrior, that knows how to get a hold of God, amen, that knows how to approach the throne of God and give God. I just have a lady in our pastor, and I won't call her name this morning. She's a heaven man. There were several times in my ministry when she was in the congregation, I'd be worried if you got something. She didn't care if there were 50 people standing out there. She didn't care. But she said, please just pray for me. You know what she did? She bowed her head. And within 30 seconds, you was in the throne room of God. You knew that she was quoting God on your behalf. You said, Pastor, he was doing it for a show, but they said, right now, I know the difference between show, say, amen. The Holy Ghost knows the difference between something that's a show and something that's real. He said, Pastor, what are you trying to say? Listen. In this text, he said, I'm looking for a man to stand in the gap. I'm looking for that one that'll make up the head. I'm looking for that one that'll take God by one hand and face him by the other hand. This is now we got to our community. I'm looking for someone that will say, Brother Dale, I'm going to go to hell, but not on my watch. That I'm going to go without warning. That I'm going to go without being loved. I'm going to go to this. The Bible, listen to me carefully. This is the proposition. If my people, which are called the Bible, I'm going to get with them to humble themselves in prayer. Take my face. This is the reason. I am wicked ways. Then, all you say, Pastor, surely, to goodness, God's people don't have any wicked ways. Then why did you put that in there? Why did David, in the book of Psalms, pray like this? Search me, O God, and try me, and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way. How to preach all right for a man after God's own heart to pray like that? You better believe you and I did right there. Think there'll be any wicked way. If my people, which are called by my name, to humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. You know what God said he'd do about that? He said, Jesus, that's an important word in the Bible. Well, I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin. Listen to me. Is that not what we need? Do we not need a healing? I'm going to tell you something, beloved. Listen, I believe it's important to both. I believe it's important. It's more than a right, it's a responsibility of the Christian to study the issues. And I hate that we're not to choose anymore, but we're not going to choose anybody that's right on all the issues. But you have to get the one that's most right. Say amen. But many times we're the picking the lesser of two evils. But it's our responsibility to go and provide. And I'm going to tell you something right now. That's not where the answer is. The answer, I'm going to see if I can do this. Give it to you where you see it. Right here. The answer is in our business. We can stand in the evil day, and we can stand in the God. But the ones that are going to stand the best will be the ones that need a little money and realize we can't do it, but he can. So I see in the text, I see the sin problem, I see the Savior's proposition in my people. But I want you to see a sad proclamation in my God. You say, Pastor, what is the sad proclamation. He said, I saw the man standing the guy before me with a lamp that I should not destroy. This is a sad, sad proclamation. He said, but I stand. You and I have been made Jesus with all of our heart this morning. We ought to be saved by him. Lord, we're glad to be with you. You're not good, not bad. I can't be killed, but I can be God. And I'm going to stand as the God. Little great day is coming along. I hope God will let me live to see it saved. I was disappointed a while ago that he was registered at some baby place and not in God's family. When is somebody going to get the phone around at 8 a.m.? There's a lot more than just going to church, going home, where you work, where you go to school, where you live. God said, I'm looking for everything. So God, what he's saying is, I will be going to go to the land, but I will find it. I will tell you this morning, I love that country. But if something doesn't happen, how many of you in this room at over 60 years old, would you raise your hand if you're over 60? Okay. How many of you that are over 60 would say, 20 years ago, you wouldn't believe what's going on right now? Let me ask you a question, though, God. If something don't happen, what's it going to be 20 years from now? They won't have drag queens in the kindergarten class and have them approaching. And by the way, there's already sodomites in the pulpit in America. I talked to a guy the other day on visitation. He said, we don't say that. I said, I do, because it's a Bible term. That's what I told him. By that time, he was headed around the back of the house, always telling me what a good religious person he was. But he didn't want to hear it. I said, amen. And that's the truth. I thank God for people that want to hear the truth. That's a big problem. But I'm going to tell you something right now. I thank God for saving you. That can solve it. Amen. He can solve it. I don't want it. I don't wish it on the mountain. But I'm going to tell you something. God is not going to apologize to solve the problem. And our day is coming. We don't think about thinking sin. Our day is coming. We're going to get the stuff left out of us. You can tell them I said so when it happens. Amen. Because God is a God, beloved. Holy and righteous. And if he didn't let the apple of his eye, that's his will. If he didn't let them get by with it, you can look up and say, our day is coming. Will you stand in the gap? Will you stand in the gap for your lost family? Will you stand in the gap for your school system? Will you stand in the gap for the man of your job? Will you stand in the gap for our community? We stand in the gap and be counted. Many ask for hands about 60 years old. Many can't do what you used to do. But I'm telling you, we need to learn from Brother Dolly. They say, Pastor, my ministry is a ministry of prayer. He was saying the other day, I can't get out of this chicken. But I can still get a hold of God. Not praying for you, Pastor. But I'm praying for a coach. Praying for a coach.
for today. And I pray this morning. I pray